That could be easily managed. Shirley wouldn't bother them. Father and mother were going to the manse, Miss Oliver never played gooseberry, and Jims always slept the clock round from 7 to 7. She would entertain Ken on the veranda. It would be moonlight. She would wear her white georgette dress and do her hair up. Yes, she would. At least in a low knot at the nape of her neck. Mother couldn't object to that, surely. Oh, how wonderful and romantic it would be! Would Ken say anything? He must mean to say something, or why should he be so particular about seeing her alone? What if it rained? Susan had been complaining about Mr. Hyde that morning. What if some officious junior Red called to discuss Belgians and shirts? Or worst of all, what if Fred Arnold dropped in? He did occasionally. The evening came at last, and was all that could be desired in an evening. The doctor and his wife went to the manse, Shirley and Miss Oliver went they alone knew where, Susan went to the store for household supplies, and Jims went to Dreamland. Rilla put on her georgette gown, knotted up her hair, and bound a little double string of pearls around it. Then she tucked a cluster of pale pink baby roses at her belt. Would Ken ask her for a rose for a keepsake? She knew that Jem had carried to the trenches in Flanders a faded rose that Faith Meredith had kissed and given him the night before he left. Rilla looked very sweet when she met Ken in the mingled moonlight and vine shadows of the big veranda. The hand she gave him was cold, and she was so desperately anxious not to lisp that her greeting was prim and precise. How handsome and tall Kenneth looked in his lieutenant's uniform! It made him seem older, too, so much so that Rilla felt rather foolish. Hadn't it been the height of absurdity for her to suppose that this splendid young officer had anything special to say to her, little Rilla Blythe of Glen St. Mary? Likely she hadn't understood him after all. He had only meant that he didn't want a mob of folks around making a fuss over him and trying to lionize him, as they had probably done over harbor. Yes, of course, that was all he meant. And she, little idiot, had gone and vainly imagined that he didn't want anybody but her. And he would think she had maneuvered everybody away so that they could be alone together, and he would laugh to himself at her. "This is better luck than I hoped for," said Ken, leaning back in his chair and looking at her with very unconcealed admiration in his eloquent